How you doing? My name's Adam, XTC, jungle drum and bass producer, DJ, living in Nottingham. How you doing? Well, we didn't have a lot to do back in the days, did we? You know, I mean, I was born 74, so, you know, we didn't have computer games, we didn't have phones, you had to make your own entertainment, so music was key. Being a child, used to, you know, kind of lay on my bed. Luckily enough, I had a pair of headphones, had a radio, and used to listen to Radio 1 at night. You know, John Peel, Andy Kershaw. Yeah, leave that in. And dragged into town as an eight-year-old into Leicester city centre. I was originally from Leicester. My mum used to go to the market, get all the fruit and veg, and there was a record shop alongside it called Revolver Records. And the sounds that used to come out there for an eight-year-old was simply mind-blowing. And luckily, as my recompense for putting up with going with my mum into town, she'd buy me a record occasionally. And I think the first one I ever bought, I'd have been eight, so 1982. Let's see if I can find it. It's in there. Ah, there you go. 1982, yeah, I'd have been eight. Oh, you got to keep all your old records, haven't you? Malcolm McLaren and the Supreme Team, Buffalo Girls. Go round the outside, round the outside. What a tune. Now, obviously, at the time, we were heavily influenced by all the old electros. You know, to an eight-year-old kid, the thing was blowing up. You were seeing people on telly on repeater spinning on their heads. And, you know, we were on in the States at home, you know, coming home from school going, this is mad. And, yeah. Malcolm McLaren, Supreme Team, Buffalo Girls, what a tune. Gio, it's right-hand side, left-hand side, mono. Anyway. L2J welcome sample. Now, Malcolm McLaren of the Sex Pistols, you know, ahead of his time, really. Counted them up, but from what I've put into Discogs, I think it was 2,500 or something in Discogs, and what I've got left, I'd say sniff under 4,000. So not a lot, do you know what I mean? It was, you know, I was working and spending a bit of, you know, every penny I had on what I got. So yeah, until I got started to get sent stuff. But yeah, I'd say just under about 4,000. Nice. I'll count for him and let you know. I really miss record shopping. Record shopping back in the day was a strategic thing. If you were on a budget, which we all were, you had to know when the tunes were coming in. You know, you found out about delivery day. You didn't mess about. Oh, delivery day was Thursday. So you made sure you were in town on Thursday. Because the shop's only got 2, 3, 4 copies max of the tunes you wanted. And if you didn't get there on, you know, within hours or minutes of tune delivery day, you weren't getting the tunes. So if you did get a gig, you know, you turn around and your mate's already been in there and got it before you. So I loved it. It was almost akin to, you know, urban going to war. You know, you'd get ready in the morning, you were into town, you had your money ready in your pocket, and you were there at the counter, arms, you knew the tunes were there. You didn't get involved in the politics, you know what I mean? The bloke behind the counter would turn around, he'd look at you and go, right, I've got two copies of this. And there was five of you on the counter, all with money in your pocket, all wanting to buy tunes that day. And he had, you know, limited copies. So you got to the, oh, we were finding it that you'd hear, because he'd play it from the beginning, and the first person that put his hand up and went, yeah, I love that, it was his. So you took the risk. The tune could have been absolute bobbins. But if you liked the first synth hook and you were going to gamble, you could have that tune. It could be yours. And that's that was the best thing I used to love about it. Because it was, you literally go, duh, 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 and like, you'd have me jostling with your mate next to you like that. And you go, yeah, yeah, I'll have that. I'll have that. I'll have a copy of that. Put that in my bag like that. But if that was yours and you secured it, you then did the actual Russian roulette of, yo, go on then, now it's mine, play the drum. But luckily, because, as I say, we really didn't know how lucky we were in the early jungle days between 93 and 95, because the majority of everything that came out was good. There was, you know, obviously with everything, there's going to be a small section of crap, but most of it was good, so you could take the punt. But yeah, my best record collection, record shop memory, is an accumulative, the jostle, the... I mean, people would fall out with you properly over it, you know, you would lose friends. If you got that track and he didn't, oof... You know, oh, I said first. No, you didn't. All of that. You know, man falling out outside. You know, it was funny. You'd even get to a stage where it wasn't like Apple for teacher, but it was. You know, who could smile around the guy who worked in the shop the most? Yeah. Do you know what I mean? It was, if you worked at the record shop, you were God. You know, they used to have egos. I'm not mentioning anybody's names. We all know who it was and not. So anyway, and you know, and you'd walk into the shop and you'd, oh, God, you know, and it was the... Is he going to sell me anything good? You know, is he already sold what he had? Is he going to just try and tell me shit? You know, it's that thing when you watch human traffic, you know. Man's got absolute bobbins and he stood there going, yeah, it's wicked. And my old kids are going, oh, is it? You know, I'm buying it, you know. But yeah, we were there in the... Oh, I miss it, mate. That's why I like your shop. Plates Records, not even fucking mate. Love it. It's the first day you walk back into a shop. And I went, it was the smell of it. I was just like, yeah. Yeah, and it's not about profit, and it's not about ego, and it's not about slickness. It's just about real good music, real good vibes, and yeah, that's what you need. That's dead easy, really. I was lucky enough to work for Mr. Music Man Records in Nottingham. Mr. Music Man Records, jungle reggae, soul, hip hop, 175 Alton Road, Nottingham, run by the Bush Doctor guys. Again, I love having my pinboard behind me. It's quite handy, actually. We didn't set this up. Bush Doctor Promotions, one of the original Nottingham massive jungle promoters before Detonate was even heard of. These guys were like ramming out Sanctuary and like massive, massive events. And they opened a record shop. I mean, this was obviously early 90s, and it was all going for it. And it was a blessing, an absolute blessing. Not only were you in the centre of the vibes, you got all the tunes sent to you, you know, much to a lot of people's dismay. But being me, I've always been about it for the vibe. That's all I've always been. But to be there, you know, having the tunes delivered. Wednesdays and Thursdays were really good days. SRD, final distribution. You would, you know, you'd make friends with the people at the end of the phone. You know, Wacko, we ended up starting up Beeswax Records. Lee, obviously. And the stuff that was coming out of vinyl distribution, you used to get all the Buckham stuff. You know, the Looking Good, Good Looking JLR, Emotive Records, everything. And, you know, I look back at it now, and at the time, we really didn't know how lucky we were. When you think you'd get, you know, two Photek releases within 3 months, you know, is that what? You know, and the music was being pushed so fast, so quickly in the bubble, and to be there at the centre of it at the shop, having stuff sent to me, to be fair, was phenomenal. And yeah, so I've got to say that as a best record shop experience, because it went from being the guy behind the counter, as in, you know, to the guy, sorry, the guy in front of the counter, sorry, to the guy behind the counter, and yeah, good times. You've took me back now, guys. I think that's going to encompass what record I have that means the most to me. I've got a couple, but if I had to pick one for A, how I got it, and B, the actual track itself, is this one. Got it out earlier. I was in a record shop, and I only got this a few years ago. I obviously got the original version when it first came out, but I was in a record shop flicking a couple of years ago and found it, saw the actual Instinct cover. pulled it out, saw test pressing, yeah, cool. Turned it out, turned it round, and there's a press release inside it. That's when it got good. Moby Go. Test press. Which was good. I mean, the tune for me back in the day as a youngster listening to DJ Master Safe play Moby Go, I mean, it was the Twin Peaks strings, but it was epic. So to find it on a test pressing for me was just, I already had it. You know, I bought every single remix I ever did. They did voodoo mixes, all sorts of different mixes. But to find the test press, you know that was the special. So yeah, for me, Moby Go. That's really bad, because I'm going to feel really bad because I actually bought it as well. It wasn't just like just came into me. This is kind of embarrassing. It's in here with all the early stuff. So yeah, hang on. Worst record I own. The worst record I own is going to be in here. The Beastie Boy. Worst record I own is the Snap Megamix. Don't ask. Don't ask. You can turn it off now. You know, to be fair, a lot of the music I bought didn't come in one. It either came in a black disco bag or just a white paper sleeve. So, but I always took the, when they came in a big thick card one, because when you're DJing, you don't want to be going around with all these big thick card covers, so you take them out. So I actually kept them all. Look, I've actually, so when it was, didn't go in, you know, so I've got, that's the old Ramster, having KLF, 3 a.m. Or is that the worst record I have? You know, Mantronic, there's all the ganja stuff. Found it. Those in the know. This is the original pressing as well for the Beard Strokers. This is the original pressing. I have a Star Wars soundtrack, 1977. 20th Century Fox Film Corporation. I don't know if it was recorded in the stereo, obviously. The condition of this. Well, that's 20th Century Fox actually on the vinyl as well. From the London Symphonic Orchestra, 1977, 20th Century Fox. It's probably worth at least £2. But I love it. And it's great. And it says Star Wars on it. Two. I can't put it down to one. I can't. DJ Die, play it for me. And Dillinger, John, are you big? Done. I have mixed those two tunes into each other for the past 20 years because I don't think any better than that for me. Yeah. DJ Die, play it for me. Dillinger, John, are you big? Nottingham. Nottingham for me has always been one of the originators. If you go back to the early dance music scenes, you used to have Head in Leicester, which was a phenomenal night. We used to have Venus in Nottingham, so Venus was a big night. Venus to me, you could pretty much say it was the original cream. You know, it was that kind of a brand, that kind of a night. So it always held kind of big for me, Nottingham. I would come from Leicester, you know, I moved to Nottingham when I was 19. Nebula 2. When you first heard that, you know, confusion, drop the bass. And then you find out it was two guys from Nottingham. It's brilliant. And I'm not just saying this because we're where we are today. I'm lucky enough to call in my mate, Jeremy Edgar. I do a radio show with him on Kemet FM in Notts, and he's basically just been there from day one, and he's pretty much one of the nicest guys in drum and bass. And he was there, he created the music, so you can't say anything about Nottingham and Joan Ebula. I was, you know, Randall knows them, Goldie knows them, all those guys know him from back in the day because, you know, he made that tune and you could make waves back then. And so, yeah, for me, Nottingham's always been on the map. Always. Today's kind of throwaway society, you know, I live in a world that makes me sick kind of in this way that people will spend £3, £2.99 on a cup of coffee, you know, some caffeine and milk, you know, drink it, throw it away. But they don't want to spend 99 pence on an MP3 where somebody's bought a studio, made music. So they'll just download it off a free website or get it off the mate on a memory stick or not buy it at all. Where back when we didn't have as many distractions with the phones, that kind of thing, vinyl was more than special to me. It was a physical thing. Every time you get the record out the sleeve, you remember. Well, I do personally. I don't know about anyone else, but where I bought it, what you know, that kind of, you're instantly taken back. Then how you felt when you first played it. Luckily for me, I can go that step further as a DJ. Who you played it to and the best crowds that went off to that one tune. So you've got a complete wall of, you know, it's like something like some graphics from Interstellar. You know, with those beams coming through the shelf. You know, I'm blessed where I can look at my records and go, yeah, that was a good night. That was phenomenal. Oh, do you remember when that bloke fell over with that one? And if to get that from a piece of round plastic is, you know, it's pretty amazing. And also with the dub plate, acetate and dub plates, special things, you know. Each one's a memory. It doesn't go away. It takes some storage. You've got to look after it, that kind of thing. Yeah. Can't be records. I'm going to find out a really well-respected drum and bass producer of today made this, and I'm going to proper look like a knob. So I apologise right now, but you know when I brought this home, I went, what did I buy that for? What did you make this for? You ready? Really? Yeah, let's sample Black Beauty, because that'll work. It works? No, it don't. Why am I dancing to it? I'm going home. I am home.